As Minister Morneau demonstrated, today's conversation and summit is not a passive one-way discussion. It is meant to be a true dialogue, and we'd like to get your questions to our distinguished speakers. So to everyone watching online, and for those of you in this room who have a question they would like asked, please tweet the question using the hashtag FinLitSummit. Our moderators will take a selection of these questions and pose them to the speakers. Now, I'd like to introduce the moderator of our first panel. Dan Kadlec is an award-winning journalist and best-selling author who has written extensively about personal finance and the economy for major U.S. news organizations, including Time, Money, CBS, and USA Today. Dan is currently writing his next book, Self-Security, Simple Money Conversations That Will Empower and Protect Your Kids for Life, which covers the basics money conversations critical for parents to have with today's youth before they leave home. Dan is a tireless advocate for early financial education and has a deep-rooted interest in examining the unique financial challenges faced by young people. Please join me in welcoming Dan Kadlec.
Thank you, Nat. And thank you all for being here. We've got a great panel we're going to get to very quickly. But first, I want to start with a story. About a year ago, my oldest daughter, Lexi, turned 25. And I gave her a birthday card. And inside this birthday card was a $50 bill. She opened the card. She saw the $50 bill, and it kind of fell to the floor. She picked it up and she said, "Dad, this is really nice, very generous. Thank you so much. But could you do me a favor?" I said, "Well, okay. What's the favor?" She said, "Would you take this $50 back and just Venmo me the money?" And I said, "Yeah, I'll do that as soon as I figure out what Venmo is." And of course, I knew, I was familiar with it. I had never used it, but I was familiar with it. And I said, "Lexi, that's very interesting to me. Why don't you want the cash? Why don't you just take the money and run?" And she said, "Well, Dad, you know, if I have cash in my pocket, I'm just going to buy something I don't need." And it occurred to me that this is exactly opposite of everything I'd ever learned, taught, written about, and practiced. For me, for our generation, for my generation anyway, when you're trying to save money, you spend cash because you feel every dollar going out. It's painful, and you spend less, and you save more. It's really common advice that we pass on all the time. But for this generation, cash is something to fritter away. They don't want it in their wallet. They'd rather track their money on a digital account. And that's so different, and it's so emblematic of how everything is changing, and technology is driving much of this change. These are some of the questions we're going to be talking about here today. You know, I saw one study where 20 years from now there'll be no more ATMs. We're headed for a cashless society, and what does that mean? And it's just sort of a symbol of what's going on. So we're going to sort through some of those questions here today. Let me now introduce the panel, and we'll get started. Yoshino-san, to my right, Dean of the Asian Development Bank and Professor Emeritus at Kyoto University. John Rogers, Chairman, CEO of Ariel Investments. John. Xu Pu Li, Executive Director of the Hong Kong Monetary Authority. Gail Hillebrand, of the Associate Director for Consumer Education and Engagement at the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. Got to be careful when I say that. It's a lot to say. And finally, Gil Beltran, the Undersecretary and Chief Economist, the Philippines Department of Finance. Gil. John Rogers, let's cut to the chase. Technology gives us real-time access to our account balances And one study has shown that that alone helped people cut their spending by 16%. On the other hand, one swipe access means we can take out a 401k loan while we're shopping at the mall. Is all this new banking technology a godsend, or is it evil?
Wow. What a way to start. I don't think it's either evil or a godsend, but I do think that technology can't overpower the importance of financial literacy. Because, you know, the world's greatest investor, Warren Buffett, talks often about keeping this simple, investing in simple ways, not getting things overly complicated, and having the right values and mindset of being a long-term investor, valuing every dollar, the magic of compound interest. He pounds home those themes over and over and over again. And I think he does that through, his written word and his spoken word. So I don't think technology is the magic bullet in this way. I think, as we'll talk about, I think it's just so important to teach kids and young people the right values as they think about investing and saving.
So it's about the technology is changing things, but it's still about the basics of how to manage your money.
Right. It all comes down to judgment, discipline, patience. I just think all those things are so valuable in whatever you're thinking about, understanding that a dollar saved is worth so much more in the future, and having that mindset of being able to think long term, I think, is critical to being a successful investor and saver.
Mr. Lee, you run a regulatory body with the stated goal of being technology neutral. You can tell us what that means, but it feels to me like an implicit recognition of the good and the bad that technology presents in personal finance. And let me labor this point for one more moment. We have apps that let us funnel spare change into a mutual fund, but we also have apps that let us buy fancy coffees twice a day without feeling the cost. There's a canceling effect if we embrace it all. How have these innovations complicated the basic task of teaching sound money management?
Okay, I probably would like to start with some of my experience. About a couple months ago, I went to a fintech cafe, and then the objectives of that event try to get to know, the future market need and also the potential customers of the banking sector. And then there are some sort of teenagers and things. And then one of the speakers talking about millennium. And then they sort of call some characteristics of these people. And then from the old generation, they consider those people, they are lazy and they don't want to work. They don't want to get up. And they hate banking services, etc. But the other sort of input from the millennium, they're innovative. They don't want to follow the traditions. And then they don't like banking service, but they like innovative financial services. So they like using mobile rather than a computer. They don't like using a notebook or PC. They just want to use mobile devices. But having said that, at the end, the conclusion of that event is in 5-10 years' time, the banking or financial services customers, probably about 40-50% are those millennials. And then you go to 10 years later, probably over 60-70% of them. So if you want to educate them, you got to use their ways. And then I remember during a coffee break, I spoke with one of them. They said, "I hate chair, I like sandbags. When we discuss project, we sit on the sandbags, not on the chair." So they're different. Okay, so if we go forward to look about financial literacy education, we got to look at things from their angle. And then banks, I think they are a bit behind in terms of providing their services to them. And we see a lot of innovative services provided by non-bank service providers. I mean, in China, there's a lot of disruptions. In Hong Kong, the banking sector, Visa, Master, and all these sort of traditional companies come to complain to us that Alipay is one of the sort of competitors of them. They're not happy seeing them growing so fast, and then they said they're eating my lunch.
Alipay.
I don't know whether you people here know that. And they initially is just a payment platform to support the Alibaba e-commerce site, mm-hmm. but they grow so rapidly. Now it's a sort of digital finance platform. They do investment, they do lending, they do P2P crowdfunding, they do insurance products. And then I've seen some of the demonstration that they, if you want to buy money market funds, it only within a minute, you can do the subscription. You got the allotment within maybe 1-2 minutes. If you want to redeem it, you can do it within 5 minutes. And then cash in your account, then you can use it for other purchases. But if you go to a bank branch, you want to buy a unit trust, it may take you, I don't know, 3 hours to go through the suitability risk assessment process. And then some of them may need to go through, depending on the scale or the amount you purchase, you may need to go through a cooling off period for a few days. But so this innovation, you know, we see in future, depending on the regulators, and we are one of them, and then we don't feel comfortable, okay, for some of them, like crowdfunding. But they do good to certain market segment. I mean, we know there's demand, you know, from some people, they want to borrow money, some people, they want to invest to those loans. And then we have seen some platforms that are very, very effective. But having said that, we got to look at it from a consumer protection angle, from an education angle. A lot of retail customers, they don't really understand the risk. We have seen failure cases, you know, in mainland China. We're talking 100,000 people lost money.
So the access is dangerous if you don't understand the risk?
Yes, but we see some benefits of those platforms, you know, because banks are not willing to do business with these people. I mean, some of them, corporations, they may want to borrow money just for 2 weeks or a month. And they don't mind to give a higher interest rate to you know, borrow those money just for cash flow purpose. And some people, they split the loan into a small unit, and then the investor can put in, like, we have seen some model that you can put in like $500 to invest on the loans, and you got 15% return. And then their innovative platform, they do the credit analysis using big data analytic. We have seen those models. It's very interesting that it's real time to get access to all kind of social medias, and also they manage to purchase data from some illegal websites like gambling websites, see whether these people actually having any illegal activity, give you a credit rating. I mean, in some way, I think bank system are not as sophisticated as those platforms. And then they do real time. And we see those movement of data, and then they can give you a credit rating within an hour. So whether this account, you know, you've got to charge it 20% interest rate whatsoever. But anyway, yeah. This technology innovation, very interesting. And from a regulatory perspective, how do we strike a balance, you know, to allow them to develop further and also protect the customers? But the youngsters, they're another factor to build into that.
So the other side of technology, Yoshino-san, is that it lets us reach students and people in new ways. Social media, text alerts, online games, comic books, maybe, I don't know. But it remains a challenge. I think it remains a challenge to get people to pay attention still, mm-hmm. does it not? How can we better leverage technology, all this new great stuff, how can we better use it to reach people with lessons that will help them manage their money?
I think the financial technology will drastically change traditional financial industries. In many countries has their own domestic banks and domestic securities companies right now. However, the access to global market will drastically change the industrial structure. Suppose US has a very efficient, good asset management company. They can approach to many Asian countries. And for example, there are two groups of countries in Asia. One is very developed, Japan, Korea, China, Singapore, Hong Kong. Another one is not so much developed, Indonesia, Myanmar. Only 30 or 40% of people, those undeveloped countries, can access to finance right now. However, they have mobile phones. Then they can access to American banks or American financial institutions. Then they can transfer their money very quickly. So in other words, the transfer of the money will become much, much more quick, and cost will be reduced. Then on the other hand, financial instability may be created, because only short-term change will shift huge amount of money from one country to another. So that is one. Secondly, financial education will become very important, because if they click some site, then they can invest huge amount of money to UK or Canada or some other countries. Then are they protected products or risky products? Those educations are very important. And in Japan, we have started matrices of education levels from primary school, secondary school, high school, and university. And we tried some good textbooks. But the problem was teachers. Most of the teachers in Japan are educated from Department of Education. They don't know anything about finance. So what we are doing is we have to teach teachers how to teach to their children.
So that's a problem in your part of the world
yes.
as well.
Yeah.
Gil Hillebrand, forget all these apps for a minute. You know, at the core, isn't what really matters is that kids grow up with enough knowledge to be confident enough to ask the right questions and to think for themselves about money and really everything else. Isn't that, taking technology out of it, isn't that really what we need to focus on? And how are we doing that? How are we doing on that level?
We have a ways to go. At the core, I'd like to quote my friend and colleague Ray Bashara, who said, financial education is what you know, financial capability is what you do with it, and financial well-being is what you achieve because of it. So we need to move away from this idea that it's only about knowledge and recognize this is a human capital skill for our countries and our populations, and then think about how you create that from childhood all the way up to the end of the life cycle. So I like to think about learning about money like learning a language. You do best if you start at home. It can be reinforced and learned in school. It has to be practiced over the whole life cycle. It makes you a better employee if you have that additional skill. And you do even better if you get it everywhere you go, whether it's the websites and the fintech that you use, or whether it's your local library or your local community social services. So when we think about innovation, we need to go beyond the tech frame and think not only about things that will be ready for people who come and get those tech items, but where are you going to find financial capability, skill building, wherever you go? So starting with K through 12, all the way up through someone who's in a youth employment program, someone who's getting social services, right through to we get to the decumulation phase and people looking at how to make what they have last for the rest of their lives.
So financial well-being is something that occurs throughout the life course. It's not something you just start with. We need to have lessons all along the life course.
That's right. There's every person in this room speaks one language, and some of you speak two or three. Not a single one of us learned that in one semester in high school. Mm-hmm. And not a single one of us learned that by someone giving us a list of words and rules. We learned it, learn, practice, repeat, grow. And that's the way we learn about money as well. And one of the issues for young people is to create some safe spaces for them to start making smaller money choices, because we also learn by making mistakes. You don't want that first mistake to be the student loan or the mortgage or the car loan. You want it to be a lot earlier in life.
You've done some work, I think, on the skill sets, the antecedents to success, the antecedents to financial well-being, the things that teachers and all of us should be trying to impart on young people, because these are basic skills that give them a better success of being financially secure later on. Could you talk about that?
Yes. We've done financial well-being research both on adults and what people define as being financial well-being in their old lives, and also for kids. I'll start with the kids part. For kids, the question not is, you know, can your five-year-old take out a loan? The question is, are they getting the skills as kids that will make them financially healthy as adults? So the adult work showed that people define financial well-being for themselves as security and freedom of choice now and in the future. We took that knowledge and combined it with what the people who are really deeply steeped in youth education know and how children develop. And they told us that this research tells us there's really three phases. The first one is early and middle childhood, so starting at age 3 to 5 and continuing up to about age 12. And there, it's executive function. Now, if you're a parent, you might think of executive function as self-control. Educators tell us there's actually a little more to it. It's also keeping multiple facts in your mind while you make decisions. And kids get that over time, but 3 to 5 and then 6 to 12 are the critical ages. They don't need to learn about borrowing money when they're 5. They need to learn about waiting and planning and making those short adjustments. In middle childhood, the research shows that it's about financial habits and norms. So this is when attitudes and personal values about money develop. And during this time, children who develop attitudes about frugality, about valuing savings, about planning ahead, and this one was surprising to me, about resisting peer pressure, do better later in later life. And once kids have these building blocks, then the ages of 13 to 21 are a much more fruitful time to deliver those, acquire and practice formal money decision-making skills, making choices, starting to develop shortcuts and personal rules of thumb. And this is the time when individual attitudes, who am I as a money person, begin to develop.
Mr. Beltran, finally, thank you for being so patient. As an economist, can you quantify what's at stake here? What if young people aren't taught how to handle their own money? Is there a cost to the global economy, to local economies, to individual economies? Can you put numbers to it, or just talk about it generally? What is the cost of failure here?
Oh, actually, the benefits of financial education is huge. In the case of the Philippines, for instance, 46% of the GDP is accounted for by savings, coming from overseas workers remitting their money, remitting $28 billion annually, and from BPOs, the business process outsourcing revenues, which account for about $25 billion of the money inflow coming in. If we are able to improve on the utilization of such funds coming into the country by only 10%, that's already 4 to 5% of GDP. That's additional growth for the economy. And if we are able to reach all of the other sectors of the economy, like 10 million microfinance beneficiaries, another 10 million overseas workers, another 50 million of students going to school, if we are able to educate all of these sectors of society, then we will have a vibrant, fast-growing economy, similar to the Korea and Hong Kong and Taiwan in the 60s.
An additional 4 to 5% of growth.
Yes.
Just through financial education, if we can make it work.
Yeah, that's possible.
So that takes me to John Rogers. let's turn political for a minute. In the United States, only a handful of states require personal finance. We're missing out on 4% growth. There's no rising trend line here. Now, on the campaign trail, we've heard more about Donald Trump's hands than we have about this important issue. What is it gonna take to get this conversation going? I mean, the conversation has started, but how can we really make it take flight?
Well, I think it does take political leadership to make it a priority, and what's worrisome is we will go through this enormous financial crisis, and so many people lost their homes, lost their 401k plans, they weren't prepared for, you know, could be prepared for retirement. So that was a wake-up call if there ever was one, and we continue to not have it as a priority. So I think it is an enormous issue. I think we have to try to get political leaders to understand that this is important, and to get it into our public schools and really focus on making sure that public school teachers are prepared to teach these important issues and get it embedded into the curriculum of the public schools. And as was talked about earlier, how do you get it like you're learning a language, have it build over time? And the other benefit, of course, is we'll have a more informed society. So not only will we have a wealthier society and have the growth that was discussed earlier, but also we'll have a literate voter who can interact with the political dynamics, understand all about the bailouts and whether they're a good decision or not. Should we hate Wall Street or not? Who do we elect as our public officials? We want to have an informed, financially literate voter who understands these key issues that can really have such an impact on our country.
Now, you've worked with President Obama on this issue. You were on his special commission for 8 years, 6 years? A while.
A long time.
A while. So we know that the president and the previous president as well was on board for boosting financial education. They have slightly different approaches, but everyone's for it. Everyone's for it. So what's really getting in the way? I mean, is it our educational system, which is run at the state level, and we can't have federal mandates? Or what exactly could we do to get over these obstacles?
Well, you just talked about one. That's one of the things that was a shock for me, was to find out that the federal government couldn't push it through. You know, we had the Department of Education and the Education Secretary, Arne Duncan, working with our Treasury Secretary and their team, Jack Lew, and everybody focused on it, but you couldn't get, you know, individual, we couldn't mandate it from Washington what needed to happen in public schools throughout the country. So I think that really is a problem and a part of this issue. The other thing I think we need to know is that we need to have more financial literate, you know, leaders, people who really understand economics and basics. As we know, often the folks who are running so much of our society are the lawyers. You know, sorry for those that are lawyers. But, you know, I can say that my parents were lawyers. But I think you need people who have that economic sophistication with our elected officials and the leaders of our governmental agencies. I think that's important. And then finally, I think there needs to be a sense of focus. There are so many well-meaning programs in the government. Basically, every cabinet agency has a financial literacy program, and all the various governmental entities. And, you know, it's great that we have the CFPB as a focus, but there's just, I think we need to have a more narrow focus, and all the various well-meaning nonprofit organizations, you know, from Junior Achievement to the Stock Market Game, there's literally thousands of them. That was, I guess, my biggest lesson chairing the President's Council, was the amount of organizations trying to fight this battle, but it wasn't coordinated. Everybody's doing their own thing. So I think the final part of your answer is, how do we get a more laser-focused or two or three key things that can really drive change for our citizens, and realize that everybody can't have their own playbook and hope they're really going to have real change.
Right. I mean, in a sense, this is kind of a normal evolution of a trend or of an event. Financial literacy has only been an issue really for 20 years. So we start by having, you know, a million different people trying to tackle it on their own, and maybe now we're getting to that point where we funnel in. And Do you think that we're kind of getting there? I mean, are we going to start having that leadership you want, or is it still, are we still looking for it?
Well, I think that one of the things we, at the end of our council, at the second term, we came to the conclusion that we really want to inspire financial institutions to partner with public schools, because that's the one place where you can have the most impact. And, you know, what we've done at Ariel is that we started a small public school 20 years ago with Arne Duncan's help, and it's really made a difference. And I think we've also had another program where we've encouraged financial institutions here in Chicago to partner with urban public schools. So I think that that's something that we have a responsibility as business leaders to find a way to get engaged with our local schools and use our expertise and talent to help public schools deliver robust financial literacy. And I think ultimately that's what we decided was a real key conclusion and a way of focusing attention in a place where we could really make a difference.
Right, and that leads, I know that I'll stay with you just for one more minute. A major theme of yours has been financial industry jobs and exposing underserved communities to those jobs. Can you talk about why that's important to you? How does that help solve the problem?
Well, I think there is a basic fairness issue, as we know that so much of the wealth in today's society and jobs are created, a lot of it in Silicon Valley, but an enormous amount comes through Wall Street. We all know the wealth that's created in private equity and hedge funds and venture capital and investment banking. You look at the diversity of this room, which is a wonderful mosaic of, you know, our country and the world here, but if this was a conference of hedge fund and private equity people, it would be 99% white men here in the room. So one is a fairness issue, that we can't have the wealth and jobs go to the same places that it always has been and not push to make change there. The second thing, of course, is when all of us who've had a chance to work in financial firms and had career paths there ultimately, our families want to hear what we know. We all know that your aunt, your uncle, your nieces and nephews come to you for financial advice because you have that job at that bank or that insurance company or whatever it happens to be. So having people of color and having diversity in the financial industry, I think ultimately has an enormous impact on our society. And then finally, as you have more and more role models, people see people successful in the field and more people get into it. And I think it becomes a real building process.
Thank you. Yeah. Mr. Lee, Hong Kong, among many other countries, seems to be counting a lot on the help from banks and financial institutions to partner in the financial education effort. I want to be careful how I phrase this here because I know who's hosting this event. And I'd like to be invited back. So allow me to just quote Director Cordray, who has said that for every $1 spent on financial education, $25 is spent on financial marketing. That means the majority of information consumers receive about financial products comes from a company trying to sell them something. Are the banks really the best advocates for financial education?
Yes or no? I think, yeah, the banking sector is important, essential, you know, to be our partner to in order to do financial education because still, I think the banking service is still the key financial services being provided to the members of public in Hong Kong. But as I said, you know, just about 10 minutes ago that we have seen a lot of non-bank service providers going into the market. They start with a payment platform, okay, and then PayPal is one of them, okay, coming to Hong Kong, and then they are applying a license from us. And then we have a lot of players from all over the world. And we have seen this kind of new evolving technological platform. They start with a payment platform, and then they add on other financial services on top. Lending, investment service, insurance service. So we feel a little bit uncomfortable, you know, to give them a payment license, but they do all things. So we want them to ring friends, other services. Okay, they need to get licenses from different regulators depending on the service they provide. But that's very common in mainland China. We see some platform, they do all kind of services. So to answer your question, banking sector is key, and they are also, you know, some of the CEOs of the major banks telling us that it's a wake-up call for them. And because they are too complacent in the past that they think, okay, they sort of monopolized the financial market in Hong Kong. But now they see all these new players coming into the market. Mm. And then because their home country, they are less or sort of in terms of regulation, they are not as regulated as stringently as banks. So they have a lot of freedom to do a lot of things. Now a lot of regulators start seeing the risk, but they also see the benefits of these players because they serve those customers that banks normally not too interested to serve those sector. And you look at Asia, a lot of major global banks, they target at the high net worth customers in terms of the private banking service. For the sort of lower level customers, normally they don't even want to open an account for them. And it may take, you know, 3-6 months, and then some of them come to us to complain. They want to open a bank account, but they have a lot of problems. I think not only in Hong Kong, we've seen cases even in the US, in the UK, you know, because of anti-money laundering. That I see some of them as an excuse.
So fintech is changing that? It's forcing or prompting the banks to compete more for the lesser desired customer? Is that what you're saying? And through that, they're educating?
They still choose, okay, those customers they want to serve, uh-huh. Okay? But they see the threat coming from the non-bank service providers. And they provide a very efficient platform. And then it's still a lot of debate about, like, for example, the KYC requirement, and then even the international standard, they are willing to adopt a risk-based approach for those called e-money service providers. Okay, then some of they have some of categories for those customers. For certain of them, they don't need to go through the KYC requirement. But for bank customer, even you only put $1 to open a deposit account, you need to go through the KYC. But this discrepancy we will see in future will be sort of closed, you know, and in terms of the requirements between the banks and non-banks. But having said that, in terms of financial education, we see we also need to work with the non-bank service providers to do financial education. We have seen more and more coming to Hong Kong. So far, we have received over 20-something applicants, those e-money service providers. And in mainland China, the Central Bank of Mainland China, the People's Bank of China, has already granted over 270 licenses for the they call third-party payment service providers. And a lot of them are really huge. And like Alipay, I mentioned that a couple of times. And then we met with them. They said they have got like 600 or 700 millions of users. I mean, in terms of number of users, more than the population in Europe. And they're still growing. and they told us that they come to Hong Kong. They don't care whether they make money or not in Hong Kong. They just want to get a license in Hong Kong. Mm. And then Hong Kong is a stepping stone for them to go to London, Frankfurt, New York, San Francisco, all over the world, and they become a payment gateway for global. Anyway, so we need to cater both of them.
Good, good. Gail, I'm going to ask you, maybe you want to break some news for us. The Bureau does a lot of research all the time. You're always doing research, and I'm sure you have some new reports coming out this year. I think I've seen hints of things that may be coming out. Is there anything you can share with us about what the Bureau is going to be working on, announcing, or doing for the next few months to a year?
Let me tell you about something we have issued recently on the next step. And if you hear the word research and you think it's time to take a nap, that's exactly wrong. I'm going to tell you about research that if you're a financial educator, you're a fintech person, you're a financial service provider, or you're interested in policy, you can use right now, today. So the financial well-being work that I mentioned defines those four elements of financial well-being: security and freedom of choice, now and in the future. Well, that sounds kind of pie in the sky. Everyone wants that. How do we know if people have it? We have issued a scientifically sound scale that people can use in their own programs or with their own employees right now to measure whether people are experiencing financial well-being, and you can use it over time to see if that's changing. It's just 10 questions, and there's a mini 5-question version, so you can use that in your programs to see if you're moving the needle, and we intend to be using it in our programs as well. So that's the first thing, the financial well-being scale. We have published the complicated academic paper and a very short version that just describes what it is and how to use it, and we'll be coming out with a user guide to make it even easier to deploy that. We will be then doing research over this next year. We're doing a big quantitative survey. We've said this publicly before, so it's not exactly breaking news, where we will be finding out for the U.S. population, for those people who answer the questions on the financial well-being scale, suggesting that they're doing all right, what do they know? What do they have? What are the social context factors? What's the family dynamic? What's the level of education? What are the things that are actually associated with having financial well-being, however you got those things. And we'll be spreading that knowledge back out to the financial education field. And we think there'll also be a role for fintech folks to think about, well, how can I help my customers get that and create that? So that's something to watch for. If you're wondering when you'll see that, if you're a financial educator, you can sign up right now on our Financial Educators Exchange. That's at consumerfinance.gov. And you'll see that, and you'll see the research that we're putting out on how consumers think about a variety of money decisions as it's published, not in advance.
Thank you. Gail, I'm going to ask you one of my favorite questions. We all know that there are critics of, well, of everything, but there are people that think financial education is a giant waste of time, that yep. that you can learn, you can teach, and kids can learn, but when it comes to making choices as adults, it all goes out the window. And this thinking is more that we should spend our resources on things like just-in-time and point-of-sale guidance mm-hmm. with adults through, I don't know, maybe apps or whatever. And The question is, how do you answer these critics? Because I think most of the people in this room would agree that financial education is critical and very important. But yet there's still a lot of people that don't buy into it for the reasons that I just said. How do you answer them?
So I think my mic keeps falling off. Sorry.
Anyone jump in, please. But
I think there are a couple of things. We have not yet had a period of time with a really comprehensive financial education for kids that really builds on these building blocks about how young people actually learn, what skills they need when. Sending a banker into a classroom once a year, that's lovely, but it's no surprise that that doesn't work. That's, you know, kids don't learn from one time. So having a comprehensive and integrated approach within the various topics, we need to really do that, and we need to measure how it works. And I believe there is a study showing the financial education having good effects in later adulthood in a couple of states where they've done it in more intensive ways. So that's one thing. In addition, we can't write off the adults. So we can have web tools and fintech, web tools provided by CFPB and others, and fintech apps for people who are ready and want to come and get it. But we also have to create the situation where wherever you go for another service, another skill in America, you also get a dose of financial capability, an opportunity to build that skill at the same time you're taking job training or social services or checking out a book at the library or visiting your library website. And we're looking at all of those ways to go about it. To say financial education doesn't make us financially better is like saying traffic school doesn't teach you how to drive. Whether that's true or not, we don't stop trying to teach kids how to drive and trying to make us all better drivers on the road as adults. And I think we have to think of it that same way.
Gil Peltran, if we had an educated public, a financially savvy educated public, would we still need consumer protections?
Oh, yes, of course. it's a type of education that continues through life until you retire. You should be looking at ways to save on your money, to make sure that before you expire, you still have something to buy medicines and things like that. It's a lifetime thing that should be undertaken by everybody. Mm-hmm. And we have a system of doing it for kids, for regulators, for legislators, because they need that very badly, very much. Even for government employees, private sector employees, there's a type of education that is needed for them. And sometimes the desire to go through it comes from them. It's not coming from outside. It comes from them because they need it. And that is what is good about the type of education that we are doing in the Philippines.
So I'm going to ask you a follow-up question. And everyone on the panel, please think about it if you want to chime in. If you had to choose three personal finance lessons that every teen deserves before graduating, what would they be? That's unfair, it's putting you on the spot a little bit, but anyone please help out. What are the three personal finance lessons every teen deserves before high school is over?
Before high school?
Before high school, before college.
Before college? Oh, what I would teach would be the type of financial products available for them. If they want insurance, bank account, a micro-insurance, because we're trying to develop micro-insurance products in the Philippines, micro-pensions.
The products, information about products.
Yes, about financial products available to everyone and the type of investments that they can make.
I would take a somewhat different approach. I'd start with stop and think. Each of these financial decisions can have longer-term impacts, so the stop and think moment is really important. And then I might go to don't believe everything you hear, and don't do it just because your friends are doing it, which any of you are parents know we always give that advice as parents, in many parts of life, including this one. And finally, the value of savings. The idea that there's more value to savings than simply the interest you earn. It's about the opportunities that you create for yourself because you have that savings cushion. I think those are the three things. Stop and think, don't believe everything you hear, and the value of savings.
Probably, I think guaranteed products or risky products. That is another difference. And the deposit insurance, and it is covered, but the stocks and bonds are not.
I think, my view is they need to learn the concept of risk. Mm-hmm. in relation to whatever, mm-hmm. even you know, investment, or even what you want to use a particular service, whether maybe even from a security standpoint. So they need to know the concept of risk before they actually go into the financial services.
And I would just add to this theme of we talked about earlier, being a long-term investor, understanding how you should be thinking long-term. And the other is how to not follow the crowd, which is also suggested earlier. You know, Warren Buffett always says you want to be greedy when others are fearful. And when these big cataclysmic things happen in our society and our economy, lean against the wind and not get swept up in the emotions of the moment, I think it's very important.
Okay, thanks. We have some questions from Tweetland, otherwise known as Twitter. I won't direct these to anyone in particular, but one person tweets, what political and social strides have been taken in the last few years to address financial stability of unbanked and underbanked individuals? I don't know. What strides have been taken? Where can we point to progress?
So there's more work to be done, but some good things have happened. We are seeing some institutions offer a safe checking account that can't be overdrawn, and that's really important for certainty and understanding just exactly how much that account is going to cost. The Consumer Financial Protection Bureau had an event earlier this year where we focused attention on the way in which accounts closed for cause are being reported and whether that was shutting people out of the system who should not be shut out. And we're hoping that will encourage people to look at what they are reporting into those systems, so only people who actually abuse their accounts, not people who just had a problem with them, get shut out of a new account.
Progress might be, I'm sorry, you had something?
Yeah, awareness of financial access is one of the things that have changed the situation. Governments are now starting to feel that there's a need for a program to enhance financial access. And even APEC has recognized this and has set up a program for developing financial infrastructure that will allow the lower levels of society to be able to access the financial sector. And this is they're doing through financial education, because that is the most important aspect of starting financial access.
One measure of progress, some people might say, would be getting financial literacy questions put into standardized test questions. Did I say that? That was mm-hmm. awkward. But basically, testing for it through standardized tests, which would encourage more lessons in school. I guess I asked Gail this. Do you think that'll ever happen? I mean, we've been talking about it for a while. Do you think it'll ever happen?
There are a couple things happening now. There are some states that require a financial education course to graduate high school. There's some states that don't require the course but require it as part of a test to graduate. And we think there's a real opportunity there to help teachers who teach other subjects but really care about their kids graduating to learn how to integrate financial ed into those courses. And I think you probably saw the announcement that the SAT made, College Board made earlier, maybe last month, that they're starting to ask some questions about the same skills they always asked about in a money context. And I think that will also help.
Another tweet. With more states requiring financial education in K-12, how can we ensure that there's funding to help schools educate students? So it's a funding question. We all want it. How do we pay for it? Anyone? a big grant?
I mean, I think it's very, very important. As we know, one of the things is we've gone around the country talking about this and trying to create model cities of success. Everyone talks about the financial challenges that people can't afford it. And we come back and with the data we've heard tonight today about how it really will impact our society in such a positive way, and from an economic growth standpoint, it's worth the investment. And you know, during our last council, we got the research from the PISA reports that showed that the United States was really in the middle of the pack when it came to how we compete worldwide. So we don't want to be in the middle of the pack. We need to make that investment here in America to make sure that we move up in the rankings and become one of the models in the world of how to do financial literacy.
in Japan, the Central Bank of Japan provides free textbooks to all the schools. And then financial associations, Bankers Association, Insurance Association, and various associations also provide free textbooks of various schools and colleges. So I think those are the ways to finance.
So another tweet. How can advances in tech help measure the impact of financial capability efforts? Let me see. How can advances in technology help measure the impact, the success that we're having in financial education efforts? How can we leverage technology to understand if we're succeeding?
So tech is helping us measure all kinds of things. We know on our website who uses which web tools. People who are offering education, web-type education, can know who goes where, how long do they stay, where do their eyeballs go. Listening to what those users actually want is going to help all of us make our tools better. But in addition, people who are offering programs can use this financial well-being scale to see, did people who took my program, are they doing any better a year later? Maybe a year is too short a timeline. This is behavior change. These are habits and skills, and they take time to develop. And those of you who work in financial ed know it's not 6 months or a year. It's a lifelong commitment for you and for the people you serve.
I think in relation to that, I believe there are a lot of data available in each jurisdiction. And also even within individual countries, there are a lot of data available. So the tech can actually help to do some sort of big data analytic about all these sort of data and then find out some common characteristics in certain areas, you know, where focus should be put on those. So I want to use an example like, you know, for banks, they normally have a lot of customer information, but in different databases. And now because of fintech, they now consolidate all these databases into one and then build a data warehouse and with tools to analyze the data. Then they can find out a lot of interesting information about their customers. So I think for education, that can be done in a similar way.
I think the development of financial technology will definitely reduce the costs of transferring money and various costs. So I think we can look at the reduction of cost in various financial industries.
Yoshino-san, I had another question that I was thinking about. In Asia, bank products, not stocks, bonds, and mutual funds, but bank products dominate the financial markets there. That's something you've said. And then these products tend to carry high commissions and fees. And I wonder, from your point of view, how does that shape the financial education discussion in your part of the world? Does that make it different from, say, the States? Or is there a different focus, or how does that affect your efforts?
In Asia, banking sector is dominating in entire financial institutions. And bank deposits are usually 2 to 5 years maturity. And Asia requires lots of big investment infrastructure, but there is no long-term investment to support those infrastructure. So insurance and pension funds has to be grown in Asia. And I think financial education will make people to prepare for their aging population and also self-protection for insurance. That can diversify the asset portfolio. And at the same time, that can provide long-term and stable money to various sectors.
I just have one more question for the panel. I'll ask you to chime in. With a thought on myths as it relates to teaching kids about money. Are there any myths? Are there any things that we believe are true that aren't true that we need to get past in order to have success?
I'd like to highlight a myth.
You know, old dogs can't learn new tricks.
Well, yeah, I'd like to highlight a myth that we hear about for adults, and it is a myth. It's been disproved by research consistently around the world, and that's that poor people can't save. This has been studied in other countries, and it has been consistently shown that people can save, that they can set goals. Those goals might be smaller to be in line with their income, but that across the economic spectrum, wherever you're starting, Financial capability skills can make your life better, and that includes savings.
It's not how much you make, it's how much you save.
Well, how much you make really matters. But the other side of it is, what do you do with what you make, and how does it help you overall? And that's the financial capability piece.
And I think there's a myth, we sort of touched on this earlier, that the financial institutions around the country are really open to having diverse teams and are really actively recruiting people of color and women into leadership roles and helping them to move up to the partnership ranks. You know, here in Chicago, there are still major private equity firms that have never had a minority professional in a leading role or a partnership role. There's the big, one of the biggest investment banks has 190 partners, one African American, and there's so many others where it's still like baseball was in 1940. So this is mythed like it was in baseball, that it, you know, was an inclusive sport when it really wasn't. So I think we have to tell the truth about that, and I think we have a responsibility here to fight for inclusion and fairness, ask the questions, and not just accept the status quo when people say things are great and we're making progress.
I was going to add one of my own. Saving is difficult. It's a myth. These days you put it on autopilot, you save whatever, 6%, you start at 6% of your pay, you automate, raising that by 1% a year till you're at 10 to 15%, whatever your goal is. You all goes into a target date mutual fund, you start when you're 20, you retire when you're 70, and you got no problems. All right, that's it. I believe we're good here. All right, thank you.
Thank you.